गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी जय गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी यशोदनंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदनंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदनंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदनंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी जय गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी यशोदनंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदनंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदनंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदनंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी। 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 जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिवराजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तरशत श्री श्रीमद हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस एसी भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी महाराज श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिवराजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तरशत श्री श्रीमद हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस श्रील भक्ति सिद्धांत सरस्वती गोस्वामी महाराज प्रभुपाद की जय। अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय। नामाचार्य श्रील हरिदास ठाकुर की जय। प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवास अधिगौर भक्त वृंद की जय। श्री श्री राधा कृष्ण गोप गोपीनाथ श्याम कुंड राधा कुंड गिरी गोवर्धन की जय। श्री ब्रजभूमि वृंदावन धाम की जय। नवदीप मायापुर धाम की जय। श्री जगन्नाथ पुरी धाम की जय। गंगा माई यमुना माई की जय। तुलसी देवी भक्ति देवी की जय। श्री हरिनाम संकीर्तन की जय। ऑल ग्लोरीज टू द असेंबल डिवोटीज। ऑल ग्लोरीज टू द असेंबल डिवोटीज। ऑल ग्लोरीज टू द असेंबल डिवोटीज। ऑल ग्लोरीज ऑल ग्लोरीज ऑल ग्लोरीज टू श्री गुरु एंड श्री गौरांगा। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवती उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 11 चैप्टर नंबर 29 टेक्स्ट नंबर 48 एंड 49। य एतद् आनंदसमुद्रसंवृतं ज्ञानामृतं भागवताय भाषितं कृष्णेन योगेश्वर सेविताङ्घ्रिणा श्रद्धया सेव्या जगत् विमुच्यते य एतदानन्द समुद्र संभृतम् ज्ञानामृतं भागवताय भाषितम् कृष्णेन योगेश्वर सेविताङ्घ्रिणा सश्रद्धया सेव्य जगत् विमुच्यते य एतदानन्द समुद्र संभृतम् ज्ञानामृतं भागवताय भाषितम् कृष्णेन योगेश्वर सेविताङ्घ्रिणा सच्छद्दया सेव्य जगत् विमुच्यते य एतदानन्द समुद्र संभृतम् ज्ञानामृतं भागवताय भाषितम् कृष्णेन योगेश्वर सेविताङ्घ्रिणा सच्छद्दया सेव्य जगत् विमुच्यते यह एनीवन हु एतत् दिस आनंद ऑफ एक्सटेसी समुद्र ओशन संभृतम कलेक्टेड ज्ञान ऑफ नॉलेज अमृतम द नेक्टर भागवताय टू हिज डिवोटी भाषितम् स्पोकन कृष्णेन बाय कृष्ण योगीश्वर बाय द मास्टर्स ऑफ योगा सेविता सर्व्ड अंग्रिणा हूज लोटस फीट सत ट्रू श्रद्धया विथ फेथ A Savior, rendering service, Jagat, the whole world, Vimuchyate, becomes liberated. Translation by the disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Thus Lord Krishna, whose lotus feet are served by all great yoga masters, spoke to His devotee this nectarian knowledge. which comprises the entire ocean of spiritual bliss. Anyone within this universe who receives this narration with great faith is assured of liberation. It has no purpose, so we're reading the next verse. Bhava bhayam apahantum jnana vijnana saram nigamakrit upjahre bhringa vadaveda saram amritam udaditas chapayayat vritya vargan purusham rishabham adyam krishna sangyam natosmi. Translation: I offer my obeisances to that Supreme Personality of Godhead, the original and the greatest of all beings, Lord Sri Krishna. He is the author of the Vedas, and just to destroy his devotees' fear of material existence, like a bee, he has collected this nectarian essence of all knowledge and self-realization. Thus, he has awarded to his many devotees this nectar from the ocean of bliss, and by his mercy, they have drunk it. Purport: just as a bee extracts nectar from a flower without harming the flower, Lord Sri Krishna extracts the essence of all Vedic knowledge without disturbing the elaborate system of Vedic advancement. In other words, Lord Sri Krishna establishes himself as the real goal of Vedic knowledge without destroying preliminary inferior processes that may be applicable to grossly materialistic men. Sri Shukadeva Goswami thus concludes by offering his obeisances to the spiritual master of the entire universe, Lord Sri Krishna. Thus, and the purports of the humble servants of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, to the 11th canto, 29th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled Bhakti Yoga. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupah Kadamahiyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Pada Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamsya He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanusute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityanandu Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So finally, this section of Uddhava Gita is ending. And just like the Gita Mahatmya mentions, Sarvo Panishado Gavo Dogdha Gopala Nandanaha Partho Vatsaha Sudhir Bhokta Pibam Gitamritam Mahat. just like Krishna extracted the essence of all the Upanishads in the form of the Gita, if all the Upanishads are like a cow, then Krishna is the cowherd boy. And the milk, the essence of the cow is the milk, and that milk is the Bhagavad Gita, which Krishna as a cowherd boy taking out from that cow. And the first recipient of the milk is always the calf. And that calf is Arjuna. And then later on everyone drinks. Similarly, here whatever topics Krishna has discussed in the Bhagavad Gita, there of course he did not have much time. It's in the battlefield, and one devotee was mentioning between 45 minutes to 1 hour. That's the time he took to speak the Gita, and Arjuna understood it also. So because it was a battlefield, so he could not go into details. But here he's sitting at, he's comfortably sitting with Uddhavji, and he's making Uddhavji now the instrument to manifest this knowledge. And this is a fact that Krishna distributes his mercy, his knowledge through the devotees. He wants to give the credit to his devotees. So Gita also, he spoke to Arjuna so that for all time to come, whenever Gita would be discussed, people could remember Arjuna. He wanted to manifest Srimad Bhagavatam, so he made his greatest devotee at that time, Parikshit Maharaj, the instrument. Now Parikshit Maharaj was such a special devotee that his birth was glorious, his life was glorious, and his death was also glorious. Even before he was born, he had the darshan of Krishna. Krishna personally protected him, and to the extent that it is mentioned, he had already died and Krishna brought him back to life. And when that child within the womb, Parikshit Maharaj, opened his eyes, the first person he sees is Krishna. And during his lifetime, he was ruling this planet. And he was so powerful, he did not allow the Kali to start, to enter. He had so much power. And his death was glorious. Krishna made the arrangement where he was cursed, and the scriptures explain the perfection of life is Ante Narayana Smriti. That if somehow or the other at the last moment we can think of Krishna, that is considered the perfection of human life. That means we have really lived our life well. Just like if we pass the exam after the full semester, so it is understood we have studied well during the semester. That's why they say life is a preparation, death is the examination. So we cannot pass the final exam unless we have studied well during our semester, during the 6 months. So similarly, anybody who can remember the Lord at the last moment, it is understood he has lived his life well, and it is the perfection of life. And for a devotee like Parikshit Maharaj, who was so surrendered, a pure devotee, Krishna made such an arrangement that he had 7 days and seven nights left. And he inspired him to renounce everything, come to the banks of Ganga. And the news spread all over the universe without any attempt on the part of Parikshit Maharaj trying to let everybody know that he was going to die. Like nowadays when people want to do something, they want people to know, they post it on social media. But for a devotee, the fame runs before the devotee, walks in front of him. Before the devotee reaches somewhere, his fame reaches. But the devotees don't want any fame. And devotees do not even want to make themselves famous. They just want to serve Krishna. And because fame is the opulence of Krishna. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada writes, when somebody becomes a devotee, Krishna starts exchanging his six opulences with him. Fame, beauty, knowledge, strength, renunciation, and wealth. So a devotee does not need to even try to make himself famous. Krishna does it for him. All the devotee needs to do is try to make Krishna famous. Like Srila Vyasadeva, when he wrote down all these scriptures, when he compiled all the scriptures, he was sitting in that dark cave in the Himalayas. Now, he did not have any news channels at that time. He was just simply selflessly working to spread the glories of the Lord and for the welfare of the people. And the real welfare work is to raise people to God consciousness. And he was simply trying, sitting in seclusion. And even then, he became famous, and that knowledge which he compiled is spreading even today. So Parikshit Maharaj, he just left everything to sit on the banks of Ganga, and he was contemplating what to do. He knew. But still, he needed somebody to speak to him Harikatha. He knew the best thing would be to just absorb the mind in remembering the Lord, hearing His glories. And the news spread all over the world. All over the universe, people, Raja Rishis, Maharishis, Deva Rishis, the great kings, they started assembling, because they understood that a great devotee of the Lord was going to leave his body, so something extraordinary was going to take place. Because Krishna makes the best arrangements for his devotees. So they came, and by the inspiration of Krishna, Shukadeva Goswami also arrived. Somebody who never stayed in one place for a time longer than it took to milk a cow, he agreed to sit down 7 days, 7 nights, and spoke the essence of all these scriptures. It is explained in the beginning of the Srimad Bhagavatam, this is the essence of the essence. This is the ripened fruit of the desire tree of Vedic literatures. Now, the Vedic literatures are called desire trees because whatever we want, we can easily accomplish with the help of the Vedic literatures. So, if they are the desire trees, then the essence of a tree is the fruit. And even among the fruit, the ripened fruit is the most important. So, Srimad Bhagavatam is that. So, Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken by Shukadeva Goswami, and Parikshit Maharaj was made the instrument. So, even while a devotee like Parikshit Maharaj is leaving the world, Krishna is glorifying him. So Krishna glorified him before his birth, during his lifetime, and even when he was leaving this world. So this is Krishna's nature, that he wants to give credit to the devotees. And he never likes to be glorified alone. And therefore Srila Prabhupada mentions that Krishna does not like the names like Krishna or Vishnu, Narayan. They do not exactly tell us about his real opulence. The real opulence of Krishna is, like Vishnu has 60 qualities and Krishna has 4 more, which are the real opulences, real qualities. Venu Madhurya, Rup Madhurya, Leela Madhurya and Bhakta Madhurya. So devotees are the real opulence of Krishna, as Krishna explains in the 9th canto, that devotees are his heart, and they know no one but him, and he also knows no one but them. So without devotees, Krishna finds no pleasure, and therefore he is always surrounded by devotees, and he always likes to be addressed by names which are in relation to his devotees, Yashoda Nandan, Radha Nath, Vrindavan Chandra, like that. And here also, therefore, he makes Uddhavji his closest associate in Dwarka, the recipient of this most confidential of all knowledge. Now, knowledge in the scriptures is compared to light, and ignorance is compared to darkness. Krishna Surya Sama Maya Haya Andhakar Jaha Krishna Taha Nahi Maya Andhakar. And darkness by nature is very fearful. This material world, Prabhupada writes, by nature is dark. We analyze that we need some artificial lighting to see things. By nature it is dark. And therefore Krishna has made the arrangement. There is the sun and there is the moon. At night there is the moon, and during the day it's the sun, which is lighting up this universe. In the spiritual world, it is by nature effulgent. इल्यूमिनेटेड, सेल्फ इल्यूमिनेटेड. वृंदावन रम्य स्थान दिव्य चिंतामणि धाम, इट इज लिट बाय द ज्वेल्स. सो मेनी साधुज इन द पास्ट इन वृंदावन, दे हैव हैड दर्शन ऑफ दैट चिंतामणि धाम वेर इट इज सेल्फ इल्यूमिनेटेड. इट इज नॉट अ डार्क वर्ल्ड, बट दिस मटीरियल वर्ल्ड इज अ डार्क प्लेस. And darkness is naturally associated with fear. And darkness is ignorance. We don't know where to go. So this, since this material world is a dark place, so naturally we need guidance, instructions. Then even in the darkness, in the midst of darkness, if somebody is there who is giving us instructions, we can reach our destination. Suppose it's pitch dark and we don't know which way to go, we can't even see ourselves. Then somebody just, a voice comes. Take 10 steps left, now stop, 2 steps right, stop, go straight. Then even in the midst of darkness, we can reach our destination if we have guidance. Like in the beginning of the creation, Lord Brahma, when he takes birth, he's sitting on that lotus, sprouting from the Lord's lotus navel, and the material universe is completely dark, and all he could just see little bit was the fearful waves of the Garbhodak ocean. He has body which is made up of intelligence, and he has he's the first created being within the universe, born directly from the Lord. Still he could not figure out the cause behind his creation, still he was fearful. And then the Lord had to speak tapa, he had to receive that instruction from the Lord personally. Then he started performing tapasya. And after pleasing the Lord with that tapasya, now he was able to see everything after that knowledge he gained, and he applied that knowledge. Just hearing knowledge, gaining knowledge is not enough. Application is most important, because when we apply the knowledge, then we get realization. And with that realization, our faith grows. Without realization, there cannot be any faith or growth in that faith. So when he heard the knowledge, then he applied it, and then he was able to see everything around him. He could see that the lotus was sprouting from Lord Vishnu's, Garbhodakshayi Vishnu's navel. He could see Lord Vishnu also. Earlier he was not able to see. What to speak of seeing Lord Vishnu, he saw the entire world, the entire spiritual world. Golok Vrindavan was shown to him. He saw Krishna, and Krishna initiated him by playing his flute into the Kama Gayatri mantra, and with that he was able to witness everything. And whatever he saw, he put it in a scripture called Brahma Samhita, which was so dear to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So all the knowledge was given to Lord Brahma, but first he had to gain instructions from Krishna. So through this only the fearful situation can be removed. Bhagavatam explains that bhayam Dutiya Vinibesha Tasya, this material world is engulfed in fear. People are constantly living in fear, and this is because of ignorance. Just like if there is darkness, there is fear. When there is light, when the sun rises, at night we are very scared. We are scared of subtle beings, something happens and we become scared. But as soon as the sun rises, it doesn't scare us anymore. Similarly, the fear is because of lack of knowledge. The fear is because of ignorance. But when the sun of Krishna, the knowledge, comes into our life, then all this fear goes away. So therefore, Brahma also, after he gained that knowledge, he became fearless. The only way by which people can be made fearless is that they have to be given this knowledge. And therefore, this is considered the greatest charity, distributing Krishna consciousness. And without this, they will always continue to live in fear. Three emotions basically around which human life is centered: lamentation, illusion, and fear. Shok, moh, and bhay. And Srimad Bhagavatam explains, Yasyam vai shriyamana naam Krishna param purushe bhagavati utpadyate pumsam shok moh bhayapah. That if someone simply receives the message of Srimad Bhagavatam, then three things disappear from that person's life: shok, moh, and bhay. And Srimad Bhagavatam is the scripture specially meant for Kali Yuga. And two things that people can do: chant the holy names and study or hear Srimad Bhagavatam. They will achieve the ultimate perfection of life. They don't need to do anything else. When you talk about scriptures, Srimad Bhagavatam is the scripture for Kali Yuga. It was written keeping that in mind under Narad Muni's instruction. Vyasadeva, when he was contemplating the welfare of the future generations, he wrote down everything: Vedanta Sutra, Vedas, Mahabharata, Upanishads, Puranas. Still he was not satisfied. Then when he wrote Srimad Bhagavatam, he felt complete satisfaction. And then the holy names, which is the spiritual practice recommended for the age. Just doing these two things is enough to achieve perfection. Everything else must assist in these two activities. So, and there are so many scriptures. Many times people come and ask, have you read the Vedas, have you read the Upanishads, have you read the Puranas? But where do we have the time? People do not even have the time to read 700 verses of the Gita. And then you have the Vedas, it is mentioned they have maybe 1 lakh verses, Mahabharata has 1 lakh 10 verses, Ramayana has 24,000, Bhagavata has 18,000, and then there are Upanishads, 108 Upanishads. So the important thing is the essence. Earlier people had time, they had patience also, they lived also quite long. But in Kali Yuga, at the beginning the average age is 100 years, that is also coming down. Gradually it will come down to, Bhagavatam says, 30, 35 years. So the important thing is to know the essence. Therefore, the sages at Naimisharanya, when they ask 6 questions from Suta Goswami, so they first explain there are many scriptures, but they specifically mentioned, explain to us the essence, because they were worried he might start going into detail and start explaining everything. Because these sages are also gathered only with the welfare of the future generations in mind. So they knew people in Kali Yuga have short lifespan. Prayanal payushah sabhya kalavasmin yuge janaha. And they are intellectually challenged, physically lazy. So we just need to tell them the essence. This is what you do. This is the conclusion ultimately. So there, the essence is explained when Suta Goswami is answering as devotional service, bhakti. It is the essence of all scriptures. So whether we study all the scriptures, all the Puranas, Vedas, Upanishads, Mahabharata, Vedanta Sutra, we can do that. Ultimately, the conclusion is that we have to engage in Krishna's devotional service. So this is one way after going through experimentation, this process. We try to find out, that may take a long time. Plus, especially in Kali Yuga, we don't have that much capacity, intelligence. So one is that, and another is simply engage in devotional service by hearing from somebody. So somebody who is engaging in devotional service to Krishna, that means he has already surpassed the studies of all the scriptures. Because ultimately, all the scriptures when we study, the conclusion will be, okay, now serve Krishna, Vasudeva Sarvamiti. And somebody who is directly engaging Krishna's service, he doesn't need to go through all that. And that is the special benediction that Srila Prabhupada and our Guru Shishya Parampara has bestowed upon us, directly engaging in the devotional service. We don't have to go through everything, they have given us the essence. And therefore, it is said that the debt that we owe to our spiritual masters, it cannot be repaid. But we can try a little bit, but it can never be repaid fully. And that try, what does it mean when we say we can try a little bit to repay the debt? And that is to share what we have received with others. That's how we can repay the debt. Like Srila Prabhupada used to say, that just try to expand the movement. I was pushed, I pushed you, now you should push others. Just sharing that. So the essence is ultimately, like Krishna is extracting the essence of all the scriptures. He extracted Gita as the essence of all the Upanishads. So similarly, in Kali Yuga, ultimately, of course, bhakti, which is the essence of all scriptures. And the essence of bhakti is the chanting of holy names. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, among all the practices of devotional service, the best and the highest is the chanting of the holy names, Nam Sankirtan. And therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is known as the essence of all avatars because he came to give the essence. The essence of everything, like in Vrindavan, they sing one bhajan called Yugal Naam Shruti Sar Hai. Yugal means Radha Krishna, Naam means the name, Sar means the essence, Shruti means the scriptures, the Vedas. So it means the Yugal Naam Shruti. If you churn all the scriptures ultimately, the essence that comes out is that the name of Radha Krishna is everything. And that is why Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is known as the essence of all avatars. Because he came to give the essence. The essence is only the holy name. Srila Prabhupada told one of his disciples confidentially, I think it was Brahmanand Maharaj or Bhavanand Prabhu, that actually, now Prabhupada had given his life for writing these books. He said confidentially, actually, you know, there's no need of any of these books. If you are convinced that chanting of the holy names is everything. All these books I have written simply to bring you to a point where you can understand that this, the holy name is everything. And Prabhupada explained, the holy name is more merciful than Krishna. To approach Krishna, you need some qualification. But to chant the holy names, no qualification is required. In fact, it creates our qualification. Once Lord Ramachandra asked Hanumanji, so Hanumanji, I have a question. And he said, yes, my dear Lord, whatever you want to ask, please. Said, is there a greater tattva than me? First he asked, who is the greatest tattva in this creation? And Hanumanji just joined his hands. He said, my dear Lord, you, there's nobody greater than you. You are the greatest tattva. You are the supreme Lord. And then Lord Ramchandra smiled. He said, okay, but is there a greater tattva than me also? And please speak honestly, please be frank, be honest. Then Hanumanji wanted to speak and then he had tears in his eyes. Lord Ramachandra said, Hanumanji, what happened? Have I asked some difficult question, a wrong question? Hanumanji said, my dear Lord, he said, whatever you want to speak, just say it. He said, yes, there is a tattva which is even greater than you. And Lord Ramachandra was surprised. Something greater than me? Said, yes. Said, then who is that? What is that? He said, your name. And Lord Ramchandra said, okay, so how is that? He said, you have appeared now and you are delivering the people of only Ayodhya and only for the amount of time you are here on this planet. You are giving them Saket, the spiritual world. But your name has been delivering countless people since time immemorial, and it will continue to do so even after you disappear from this world. So isn't your name a greater tattva than you? Then the Lord was very, very happy. He embraced Hanumanji. So those who are actually devotees, they, as Radhanath Maharaj many times mentions, a devotee is saragrahi. He accepts the essence. He knows the essence, he accepts it, and he preaches it also. Saragrahi. Saragrahi doesn't just mean absorbing the essence, but also sharing the essence only with others. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu therefore brought that essence. And when he was, now who is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? He is the Lord only, Krishna only. But coming as a devotee, teaching all of us how to practice devotional service. How to lead a devotional life, how to connect with the Lord. And what did he do? Because he wanted to preach by his own example. So what did he do preaching by his own example throughout his life when he was in Navadvip? Constantly at Shivas Thakur's house, he was simply chanting, doing Sankirtan, day in and day out. First they were doing it during the day, then one day Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, why should we waste our night sleeping? And then everybody was very blissful. They chanted Jai, that we'll chant at night also. And these were eternal associates of the Lord, so they had that much capacity. They became ecstatic. Like Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj once, he had few disciples, few followers around him. He told them, so tomorrow we'll have a festival. And everybody became ecstatic, thinking festival means there will be a feast. So somebody, as they say, curiosity kills the cat, but somebody asked, okay, Babaji, so what we'll do? What we shall be doing? He said, so we'll get up early, we'll chant the holy names. And then we'll do Sankirtan, we'll dance. Then after that, we'll again sit down to chant. Then we'll again do Kirtan. And then chant and do Kirtan. And this way we'll spend the whole day. So he was in that mood and he had that much capacity. But others, they're just, the faces changed. Sometime back they were looking blissful, suddenly they became morose. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he declared, why should we waste our life or night sleeping, we should simply chant Sankirtan, everybody just jumped. And Prabhupada mentions that when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was with his devotees at Srivas Thakur's house, they did only three activities exclusively. They chanted Krishna's names, they worshipped Krishna, and they discussed Krishna. Three things: chanted the names of Krishna, discussed Krishna, and worshipped Krishna. These are the only three things Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did. And Prabhupada writes in the purport that our movement will spread not because of any expert management or special talents. Our movement will continue to grow. It will spread only if the members of this movement remain faithful to these three principles: chant Krishna's holy names, discuss Krishna, and worship Krishna. If we remain faithful to these three principles, then Srila Prabhupada writes, our movement will spread. Because everything happens by the pleasure of Krishna. So when we please Krishna, Krishna, as I said, he exchanges whatever he has with us. So we allow Krishna, when we focus our consciousness on Krishna, we depend on Krishna, then we are actually allowing him to work through all of us. And his power is unimaginable, and he can make the impossible possible. And that's what actually the pure devotees of the Lord do. They don't have any ego, they just become transparent via media of the Lord, of the mercy of the Lord, and therefore they are able to accomplish the most difficult tasks also, because they are allowing Krishna to work through them. They are fully surrendered. Like Srila Prabhupada writes in his poem at Boston Harbor when he reached, he says, Krishna, make me your puppet. Make me your puppet and make me dance the way you like me to dance. So devotees are completely surrendered. They are just puppets in the hands of Krishna. And then Krishna makes them dance the way he wants them to dance. And Krishna is perfect. If we want to dance on our own, according to our whims and fancies, based on our own intelligence and mind, then we are limited, we are imperfect. But then we allow Krishna to use us. And this is the greatest, most glorious position one can have, where we become qualified to be used by Krishna. Then Krishna will manifest his grace through us. Krishna has a will, he has a plan, and he will use his most surrendered devotees to execute his plan. And he sees. And how do we gain Krishna's trust? When he sees that we are sincere in following what he wants us to follow. So when the Lord has a mission, he says, okay, a little bit is given, he has done it properly. Now he gives more, he gives more, he gives more, more and more responsibilities. And when he sees that a person is not doing what he wants him to do, then he chooses somebody else, whoever is ready to do that. So simply remaining faithful to what Krishna wants us to do, and worship Krishna, chant his holy names, discuss Krishna, this is how things expand, this is how things will continue to expand. Therefore, Srila Prabhupada always used to say, purity is the force. If there is purity, then automatically things will spread. If there is impurity, things will fall apart. So purity is the ultimate force. And there are so many people do Bhagavad, there are so many people who chant also professionally, people sing Krishna's names and... But since there is no purity, the consciousness is not pure, they don't create any impact. But even, and even if they have the best of musical accompaniments, but a person simply chanting without any musical accompaniment also, he can create the greatest revolution. When Srila Prabhupada sat down in that Tompkins Square Park, he did not even have an amplifier. He just had a simple drum. I was playing one beat, singing only one melody. And people get bored when sometimes the same melody is sung. So nowadays people try to sing different melodies, try to cater to the taste of the audience. So none of these people, actually none of the parties truly benefit, because they are mesmerized by the melody, not by the holy name. And Prabhupada was mesmerizing them with the holy names. He was sitting under that tree, chanting only one melody without any amplifier, and gradually things started manifesting. So he let the holy name do the work. And there's nothing within the three worlds which cannot be accomplished by the power of the holy names. Sitting in one place, the whole world can be, we can create an impact all over the world. So this is the essence. Krishna brought out the essence, he gave it to Arjuna, he brought out the essence, he gave it to Uddhavji. Through that, it is given to us. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Yuga Avatar, who is the incarnation for this age, he brought out the essence of the essence which was given to Arjuna and Uddhavji also. And that is the chanting of the holy names. And if we can just simply accept it, then that means we have surpassed the studies of all Vedic literatures. We have traveled to all the holy places. We have traveled to all the holy places within the universe. We have done all kinds of austerity. We have given all kinds of charity. Because all these provisions are made by Krishna, they are mentioned in the scriptures, to gradually purify our heart and understand that Krishna is everything and His holy name is the everything. So if we are directly doing it, then we have surpassed all this. And if we continue to do it, then hopefully one day we can expect Krishna to work through us also. Maybe not in this lifetime, even if million lifetimes. But if we stick to the path which is shown by Krishna, specifically by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, sticking and taking this one activity, chanting of the holy names, as our life and soul, then we also will be able to accomplish the impossible. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Time is up.